Just three sleeps to go until Sydney wakes up to freedom. But there's concern among doctors the state could be moving too fast, too soon. New Premier Dominic Perrottet yesterday unveiled a further loosening of restrictions, including allowing 3,000 people at outdoor events once the 80% target is reached. The New South Wales branch of the AMA warning making the wrong move will not only set the state back, but have ramifications right across the country. Let's bring in Chair of the New South Wales AMA, Dr. Michael Bonning, who's in Sydney. Good morning, Dr. Bonning. We've seen the consequences of opening up too soon overseas. Just how much pressure could be put on the New South Wales health system?
Morning, Charles. I mean, that's the real question here. The difficulty is that our system is already stretched. You know, it hasn't reached those highs that were entirely predicted, but it's certainly, you know, across hospitals across Sydney, across New South Wales, have been very stretched by COVID, and that's in a setting where we are putting off non-urgent care for people. We are asking people not to have their surgeries. We are, you know, not allowing lots of non-COVID care to go on, and we are still very tight for capacity within the system. And we only have to look to non-hospital-based systems, so things like our AMBOs, to know that there's a real stretch there as well on our ability to cope.
For so much of this pandemic, the response has been based on the state's Chief Health Officer, Dr. Kerry Chant. She was missing from yesterday's announcement. Is that telling?
Dr. Chant has been an incredible... She's been an incredible health advocate. She's also been an incredibly consistent voice for health advice, and that is exactly it. The consistency of health advice, and also that we saw a plan that the AMA was fully on board with here in New South Wales that took into account that health advice. Now, we don't know the inner workings of what's going on within the cabinet and within how the health advice is being taken, but what we have seen is a significant change from where we were. And this is all about protecting New South Wales. People in New South Wales have done so much. They have followed the health advice. You know, we as a state may well end up a world leader in vaccination, and we just need to give it a couple more weeks to get there, and this acceleration potentially undoes some of that good work.
Parents right across the country are waking up to the news that Pfizer is seeking approval in the US for a COVID jab for 5 to 11-year-olds. Do you think that needs to happen here?
The progression of this to younger age groups is entirely consistent with what we would expect, that this is a transmittable disease by children, by adults, and so the opportunity to vaccinate younger people is entirely consistent with having a good response, because as we see it, 70% of over 16-year-olds still leaves a large proportion of the community unvaccinated, even though we say 70% is an average for those people over the age of 16, it's patchy. So 47% of people between 16 and 19 who are highly likely to interact with dozens or hundreds of others in the next months are only vaccinated at this point. So we need to see those vaccination rates go up. We want to address the vaccination of 5 to 11-year-olds when that becomes authorised in Australia. And, they're the next things we need to do, because COVID isn't over. We're going to live with this. And, you know, New South Wales has at every stage in the pandemic been a leader in Australia, but it needs to be careful and think about how it uses restrictions, including mask wearing, to continue to be that leader rather than becoming reckless and going away from a health advice plan for reopening.
Yeah, Dr. Bonning, it seems like when, not if, with those children's jabs, but we thank you for your time this morning.
After 3.5 long, painful months, on Monday, businesses across Sydney will finally be able to open their doors, but it comes with challenges. Owners already crying out for help in policing vaccination rules and capacity limits. For more, we are joined by three business owners across the city. We're going to go first to Fit for All gym owner, Milton Caravas in Penrith. Milton, thanks for joining us this morning. I know you've been closed for more than 100 days. It's been pretty rough, no doubt.
Oh, definitely. It's been polarising, it's been demoralising for our family and our children as well.
You all right?
Oh, yeah. we're okay. We're hanging in there.
Yeah, that's it, isn't it? It's just kind of hanging in there. So how are you feeling about what happens come Monday?
Oh, extremely apprehensive. To have to be forced into discriminating against our community is not something that we've ever wanted to do. But unfortunately, we just couldn't wait till December the 1st to open. It would just totally destroy our business and possibly send us bankrupt. So, no, unfortunately, we're going to have to open on October the 11th and face the consequences of all the logistics that comes with that too.
And that's where it's tricky, isn't it? Because obviously the vaccination passport check-ins, they're not ready. So it's going to fall to you to police it. And obviously I can see from, you know, your demeanour this morning that you feel that is quite a burden.
Oh, certainly is. It's hard enough running a facility without 15 pages of COVID safety plan on top of having to ask our staff to be security guards for the government. It's just not something that, you know, they've equipped us with. So we just hope we don't end up one of the scapegoats.
So what's going to happen? You'll have someone on the front door just checking and making sure people are vaccinated?
Yeah, at this stage we've had meetings with all our staff members to go through a pretty standard process of what they're going to expect of members. But we also hope that the government has informed everybody of their individual responsibility so that they know if they're not vaccinated, well, they know themselves that they shouldn't be attending our facility. And so we're hoping that our community, which has been really loyal to us, continues to do that and is hopefully understanding. And, yeah, we're just and try and do our best.
Yeah, this is where it's tricky for businesses having to navigate this and telling people who aren't vaccinated that they can't come in. I want to go now to the owner of Hair Angel Salon, Deborah Bradshaw in Balmain. Deborah, how are you feeling about opening on Monday?
Hi, Ali. Well, there's a lot of intrepidation, obviously. One of the things that's really difficult for us as hairdressers and the thing that I've been quite concerned about for myself, my team, and all hairdressers, really, everybody in the beauty industry across the country, is that really we are usually a sort of confessional for our clients, and that's lovely, and we share stories and they, you know, really confide in us. But all we've had to talk about is COVID for the last 3 months. We don't have any of those lovely stories. And actually, it has really sort of concerned me to the point that I have started a campaign called Keep Your Mane Sane. Hairdressers can even order these lovely T-shirts. We're going to be wearing them here in the salon. We have signage everywhere, and we have these lovely conversation starters. So we're going to try and say to our clients, please don't talk about COVID. Let's leave that outside, and let's have some really great, fun, and interesting conversations.
Deborah, I love this idea, a COVID-free zone, hopefully in regards to the virus, and also not even being able to talk about it. But I know that it is tricky for you guys because you're only allowed 5 clients, regardless of the size of your business. So how is that going to impact you?
It's impacting us already. I mean, I'm up till all hours of the night just trying to work around the scheduling. We have a backlog of 3 months of clients. They all want to get in as soon as possible. They want to have the service they want done on the day and the time that they want done with the stylist they want done. But I can only have 5 clients in the salon at one time. It's honestly, Ali, it's like Tetris at the moment. Mm. I'm up till 1, 2 in the morning trying to schedule everybody in. It's crazy.
Could you handle more clients safely following the COVID rules of 1 per 4 square metres?
We absolutely could. I mean, I'm in a very beautiful salon in Balmain. I have 2 floors. I've got 3 different rooms. I have 110 square metres. Like, I absolutely could take way more. And it's just so terrible after 3 months of being shut down. We want to get some money in the door. We want to look after our clients. We want to keep our business viable. And I can only take 5 at one time. Mm. It's devastating.
Right, well, let's go now to Aussie chef Neil Perry. He's at his Double Bay restaurant, Margaret. Neil, I couldn't even get my head around what was happening with the rules in regards to restaurants yesterday. There was all this hoo-ha about whether you can have this 20-person cap per booking. Where is that sitting at the moment, and how's it going to impact you?
Well, at the moment, the largest table is 20. There was rumours that it would change. I mean, we're happy. We're a small restaurant, so that's good for us. You know, we've got the restrictions of 4 square metres. We're dealing with that. We've got a small outside section, so that gives us some flexibility. But we're really just moving towards Monday and opening on Wednesday with, you know, really strong COVID safety plans, really making sure the staff know their responsibilities to each other, and then hopefully working with our customers to make sure that they're very safe as well. So, look, we've been dealt this deck of cards, and you know, you can complain and you can do this and you can do that, but the reality of it is in a once-in-a-hundred-year pandemic, we're putting our toe in the water and opening. I mean, it's not Freedom Day on Monday. Freedom Day is when all Australians get to be together. It's opening the economy day and putting our toe in the water. And I hope as we do that, that we don't have a massive outbreak because, you know, we love all those amazing nurses and doctors that have been so incredible the last 18 months and we don't want them overwhelmed.
Yeah, look, we've all got our fingers crossed for that. How are bookings? Because I know you were just about to open up when this lockdown hit.
Yeah. Yes, well, the day that we were supposed to open, lockdown hit. So it's very strong. We're in a very similar position, only, you know, we've only got sort of about 60% of the capacity that we had when we were about to open in June. But, again, we'll just deal with that and then hopefully we get to December 1 and we get back to 2 square metres and then hopefully next year life becomes a little bit more normal and we get to travel. And I'm working like mad on Qantas at the moment because we're about to sort of open lounges and airports in LA and London and, you know, Singapore. And, I mean, that's just super exciting in itself.
I just love hearing that you're busy and apologies for my promised non-COVID cough there early, which interrupted
that. I've had terrible hay fever the last 3 days. There's just pollen everywhere at the moment.
I'm blaming that too. Hey guys, nice to talk to you all and good luck with next week. It's, you know, it's going to be a bit tricky, but I'm just so glad to see that you're all opening your doors and hopefully we can get back to normal pretty quickly. You take care and we'll talk soon. Yeah.